So each and every night we'll sing that together, but tonight I just wanted you to focus in and learn that you can turn to Him in any time of need and any time of trouble. He's always there for you, and He'll be there when you need Him most, or when you need Him most. If you're ready for the message, Brother Mike, you can come down and we'll get into His Word.
So, before we get started, I'm going to ask. No, I forgot your name. Of all people. Huh? Andy. I was going to say Andrew. That would have been okay. Andy, will you open us in prayer? Thank you. I had a senior moment there.
Yes, you did. Heavenly Father, we love you and just thankful that we have the campus week, Lord. And we just pray that the next 15, 20, 30 minutes, Lord, that we go up to you, Lord, and we listen attentively, Lord, and take up something that would be good for our souls, Lord, and good for our lives, just for the rest of our life, Lord. Just pray that we commit this time to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right, so we're going to look at our verse tonight a little bit. I'm going to read something, and then we're going to stop. It says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God." And so that's the question we're going to ask tonight. Is He your God? This verse means absolutely nothing if He's not your God. There are no promises like that for people who are not Christians. God is not with you. God is not for you. God is not anything to you if He is not your God. We hear people say all the time, "Well, we're all God's people." No, we're not. And we're going to talk about that tonight a little bit. We're not all God's people. Only Christians are God's people. Only a Christian can call God their Father. If you're not a Christian, God is not your Father. I remember one time we had this boy who was coming over our house a lot, and he started getting really close to my dad. And I got jealous. And he said something about my dad being his dad, and I said, "Oh, no. That's my dad, not your dad." And I got upset, because that's not his dad, it's my dad. Only Christians can call God their Father. Only Christians does this verse mean anything. God is not there to comfort you. He's not there to help you. He's not there to strengthen you if you're not a Christian. Well, that sounds bad, doesn't it? But it's the truth. See, one thing I tell all my clients and I tell everybody, I'm just going to tell you the truth. You be honest with me, I'm going to be honest with you. Honestly, if you're not a Christian and God is not your Father, this verse means nothing. We need to read, we're going to read right now, in John chapter 10. John chapter 10 says, we're going to be in verse 25. "And Jesus said unto," answered them, "I told you, and ye believe not. Not the works that I do in my Father's name. They bear witness of me. But ye believe not, because you are not of my sheep. And I have said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them to me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand." So Jesus even said that His sheep hear His voice. And the reason you're not one of my sheep, He says, is because you don't believe in me. One of the ways that we know that we're Christians, one of the ways that we know, girls, it's not nap time. Somebody wake them up. Hello. Wake up. Wake up. All you got to do is give me 10 minutes. Sit up. Sit up. Give me 10 minutes and that'll be okay. All right. So one of the ways that we know that we're a Christian is that God speaks to us and we hear Him. Did He not say, "You hear my voice and they know me and I know them"? So Mike, what do you mean? Hear God's voice. I tell people that God talks to me and they say, "What does He sound like?" And I think for a while and I said, "Like me," because I don't know how to explain it. There's not a voice from heaven that comes down and says, "Dude." There's this voice inside my head and my heart that talks to me. But let me explain it to you better. And Cole kind of knows this story. Where I'm a pastor of a church right now, there was a man who came to our church one Sunday morning. He was determined to kill his neighbors. He'd been having troubles with them for a while, and it really got to a point where it was going to be violent. And he gets in his truck and he starts to drive around because he's a Christian and he's bothering him, but he's going to kill them. He had all the intentions in the world of killing them that Sunday. Somehow he finds our church and he comes in. And guess who's preaching? Not me. Cole is. And Cole preaches. And when he listens to the sermon and he's there for the songs and there for church, guess what he did not do? He didn't go and kill those neighbors. Now the next Sunday I show up and there he is and I'm preaching and he comes and talks to me about it. And he said, "I had all the intentions in the world of killing them. But I came to church and I heard the sermon and God spoke to me." See, when you're a Christian, God does talk to you. And you know His voice. God tells you. He speaks to you and says, "Do this or do that. Don't do this. Don't do that." Not everybody is a Christian. Not everybody has God as their God. There are a lot of gods out there. There are. Some of them are rappers or rap music. Some of it is, you know, even rock music. Some of it is even Christian music. Whatever you worship becomes your God. Whatever it is that is more important to you than God is your God. For example, is it wrong to play football?
No.
Thank you, whoever said that. It's not wrong to play football. Is it wrong that that consumes your life? Yes. If all you can talk about is football, all you can do is eat and sleep football, you don't go to church because you go to football practice. You don't go to youth group because of football practice. You don't read your Bible. How often should you read your Bible?
Every day.
You're not reading your Bible because you get up too early to go to football practice. You don't have your prayer time because you're reading, instead of reading the Bible and all that, you're spending your time in your playbook. You eat, sleep, football. What has become your God? Football. There are many gods out there. And a lot of things that we use, that we rely on to get us through. Do you know most people's God is themselves? That's who most people's gods are. Me. Somebody, one time we were driving down the street of Chicago and we saw a guy shooting up. And we were talking about how sad that was. And somebody, as I'm driving the van, said, "Mike, what is the number one addiction in America? What is it?" I said, "That's easy. self. The number one addiction in America is self. We love us. And a lot of times we become our God. How do you know? Troubles come, turmoils, and who do we go to for answers? Ourselves. I got this figured out. I'll do this, I'll do that. Maybe I'll lie, maybe I'll steal, maybe I'll cheat. But I got this figured out. Or, you know what? I know exactly what to do. And we go to ourselves. Hey, you know what? I got myself where I am today. You ever anybody say that? Don't get me wrong, good hard work is great. Good work ethic is great. But people say, I got myself here. The Bible tells us a story about a man who had a farm and he had a harvest, a great harvest. And he built another barn to fill his up. And he said to himself, you know what? I've got plenty. I can retire now. I've got it made. And Jesus said to him, or God said to him, you fool, your soul is required of me today. And too many of us rely on what we do, our answers. Your God is yourself. You don't have to worry about the devil a whole lot. He just lets you go and do what you want to do. We got it figured out. I remember when I was 15, I thought I had life all figured out. I thought my mom and dad were pretty stupid. Somewhere around 25, they really got smart. Somehow they got smarter in those 10 years. Our God is ourselves. So the question today is, do you know God? Do you know Him? Is He your God? So many of us think that He is. Think that He is, but He's not. You know how I know? Who here reads their Bible every day? Very few of you. Now, whether you're Christian or not, very few people read their Bibles. Very few people here even have a Bible. You're living in the United States, you can go to the Dollar Tree and get it for a buck. How many of you here have prayer time every day with God? Very few of you. How many here go to church when church is open? Very few. But you want to read that verse and say, look, look what God will do for me. And the answer is no, He will not. He's not your God. And you may be a Christian and say, yeah, He's my God. I'm a Christian. Is He? I want Him to do all these things for me. Yet you do nothing for Him. Is He your God? Is He? Do you really know Him? Christians have a desire to know God. Now, we read in here in these verses that if you believe in God, He'll keep you forever in heaven. You'll have eternal life. And we're talking this week about fear, right? And what to do. The greatest fear that we have is what happens after we die. That's the greatest fear that we have. What happens to us after we die? Some say we're just here on this earth and we die and that's it. Others say there's a heaven, and others say there's a hell. I say there's a heaven or hell. When I was a Christian, when I was little, before I got saved, I remember going to a revival service, and the preacher was preaching on hell and heaven. And he began to preach, and he talked about how heaven, hell was a place of continual fire. It never burned out. Continual fire. Now, I've burnt myself a couple times, and it hurts. We were talking today about getting sunburned and getting freckles. One time I got sunburned so bad on my shoulders, it bubbled up. You ever seen that? It had little bubbles all over me. And it hurts so much. I could not imagine being in the flames forever. And as he spoke about that, talked about how it was completely dark. You can't see anything. You know, those people say, I can't wait to go to hell, and my friends and I are going to party all the time. There's just going to be wild music and wild. You can't see anything. And the Bible talks about how there's hollering and screaming constantly because of the pain. So can you imagine being in complete darkness, in pain, people grabbing and hollering? They're grabbing you, they're hollering, they're screaming, you're screaming, you're hollering, forever. Listen, if God is not your God, that's where you'll end up someday when you die. And that was my greatest fear at that moment in that time. I didn't know much about anything else in life. I was only 6 years old. But they had an invitation, and I ran down the aisle. Almost ran down. Went to the preacher, he shook my hand, he said, Mikey, why are you here? I said, I don't want to go to hell, I want to go to heaven. Can you show me how? And he showed me that if you believe in Jesus Christ, you can live forever in heaven. The greatest promise that he has there is that no man can pull you out of God's hand. Once you become a Christian, God holds your soul forever. And nobody can pluck it out. Not even the devil himself. But that's only if he's your God. You're not in his hands if he's not your God. So the question again is today, is he your God? Christian, is he your God in your life? Do you worship him? Do you serve him? Do you read your Bible? Do you go to church? Is he really your God? Or are you just substituting him for yourself? Those of you who are not Christians, and I don't know who is or isn't, today is the day to make him your God. This verse means nothing. We can quote it all week. And it means nothing unless he's your God. He's your God. Did you know the guy who came to our church because he was afraid of killing the family next door? He kept coming. He kept coming. He's still coming. He was here last Sunday. And I've seen how his life has changed. Did you know he starts bringing his family? He's bringing his family now and children. His whole life has changed because he listened to God. And he's determined to make God his God. God can change your life today. One can save your soul, and you never have to worry. You never have to fear hell again. I don't know what it's like to fear hell anymore. It's so far away from me, I don't even think about it. If he's your God. Christian, make him your God today. Make him your God today. Learn to start reading your Bible every day. Learn to have prayer time with you and God every day. Learn to go to church every time you can. Make God your God. It's okay to play football. It's okay to listen to music. It's okay to like movies. It's okay to do other things in life. But God is my God, and He comes first. And so, yes, I might have to go to practice, but I'm going to read my Bible first. Yes, I may have to go to practice, but I'm going to read and have my prayer time. Yes, I'm going to go to practice, but if practice is on church day, guess where I am instead? Church. Church. I know that's not always easy, because I used to coach Little League Baseball, and they started having Little League games on Sundays, and I said, I won't do that, and my sons won't be here either. So we'll have to forfeit. Okay. Because God is my God. I want this verse in my life. I don't want to be dismayed. I want strength. I want to be upheld by Him. I want God to hold me and get me through. And there is troubles that come in my life, and I want Him there for me. But I have to make Him my God. Every head bowed, every eyes closed. We're going to get ready for an invitation. I have the counselors come up front. Or is in the back? We go to the back, don't we? Go to the back. Every head bowed, every eyes closed. This is your time. Maybe God is not the God of your life, and you can't claim this verse because you're not a Christian. You're not a Christian. Every head bowed, every eyes closed. If that's true, you can get up right now, go to the back, and go to your counselor, and they can show you how you can make God your God. He can be the God of your life, and you can start claiming this verse. Maybe you're a Christian here, and God is not the God of your life. You're not serving Him. You're not reading your Bible. You're not having prayer time with just you and Him. You're not going to church. Maybe you want to change that right now and get up and go to the back and pray with your counselor and say, I want to make God number one in my life. I want to claim this verse. I'm going to have troubles and I want God next to me. I want God to strengthen me. If that's you, get up now and go to the back and pray with your counselor. This is your time to do just that. Is He your God?
Message, guys. Hopefully, you will challenge yourself.